fasting has been around for thousands of years. And research is constantly changing every minute, every day. So you can't always look at just the old imprint of fasting from thousands of years ago and not take into account the new research. So now we can look at intermittent fasting and we can look at the evolution of research and learn what we can drink during a fast that is going to enhance the benefits of a fast. At first glance, we look at a fast and we think, well, it should be consumption of nothing. But the reality is there's little things that have little to no calories that boost the known benefits of intermittent fasting. And we're gonna talk about them, and you're gonna walk away from this video with 5 or 6 beverages that are gonna make your fast that much more effective. Hey, I do wanna make sure you hit that red subscribe button and then make sure you hit that little bell icon to turn on notifications as well. All right, let's go ahead and cut right to it. Apple cider vinegar and lemon combined is extremely powerful when it comes down to fasting. Why is this? Well, it has to do with the acetic acid, all right? So the acetic acid is the component in vinegar that upregulates fatty acid oxidation. So when you're fasting, your body takes fat from your storage form, mobilizes it into the blood, and turns it into energy. It turns out the acetic acid that's in apple cider vinegar mobilizes this and improves the speed at which it happens. But that's not it. It also increases uncoupling proteins, which make it so that your body just emits more heat. So even though when you're fasting, you might feel cold, it's now totally normal and natural, you're actually producing more heat because you have more uncoupling protein, more cells, if you want to call them that, proteins that are releasing energy. It's really cool. Now, the other thing we have to look at with acetic acid is it upregulates something known as AMPK. Now, you're probably thinking, Thomas, just give me the details and let it go. But I like to explain the science and some like to hear it. Okay, so AMPK is an energy sensor in your body. The moment that your calories are lower, like you're restricting calories or you're fasting, AMPK is a sensor. It says, uh-oh, not enough energy right now. So let's go ahead and let's start recruiting energy from cells and let's start inducing what's called autophagy that you've probably heard of before. Autophagy is where your body basically takes cells and recycles them for energy. There's no food coming in, so it starts eating its older, decrepit cells. Okay, so this gets induced by AMPK. Now, the downside of AMPK is when AMPK goes up, it also goes up in the brain, and that makes you hungry. So it's tough. We want AMPK to be up in the body, but we don't want it up in the brain. Well, here's where things are interesting, because acetic acid has the ability to improve AMPK in the body, meaning you're burning more fat, you're having more cellular regeneration, but it also simultaneously drives it down in your brain so you don't feel hungry. So it's going to help the fast in two ways. Then you're gonna add lemon to it simply because the pectin, which is a soluble fiber in lemon, pretty much has no calorie count, and it ends up helping the detoxification process because the soluble fiber pulls toxins out of the intestinal tract and out of the body. So you might be thinking, well, there's gonna be like 1 or 2 calories in this drink. Yeah, but quite frankly, the benefit that you get from them far supersedes the 1 or 2 calories, okay? Now let's move into one that you're gonna love to hear, your cup of Joe, black coffee. Why is black coffee so important? Well, number one, it boosts what are called catecholamines, epinephrine, norepinephrine, and adrenaline, which up until now you might have thought were bad. But they're really good because in this case, you're under stress when you're fasting. You're not eating, so your body's stressed out. So it means it improves the release of the stress hormones, like adrenaline, stuff like that. Well, guess what? Adrenaline also calls upon fat to get released because it's like, hey, we need all hands on deck and we need to burn fat. This is a great thing, and caffeine in coffee improves this. Now, additionally, it's what is called a phosphodiesterase inhibitor. Phosphodiesterase usually cuts off like the messenger, okay? Phosphodiesterase normally in the body cuts off the communication to release fat. Well, the cool thing is caffeine and coffee is a phosphodiesterase inhibitor, which means it stops the stopping of the messenger. It basically kills and eradicates what would normally cut off the message. So the body is now free willy-nilly to say, hey, burn fat, and it does. Now, of course, then there's one side mention that we have to take a look at with chlorogenic acid. Okay, that's gonna just make you feel satiated and also gonna drive down your insulin levels, so you essentially get into a fasted state faster. But then there was something interesting that was published in the journal Cell Cycle. It found that when you consume coffee, both decaf and caffeinated coffee triggered autophagy in the liver and in some other organs. Whoa, what's going on here? Well, it turns out that the polyphenols in coffee trigger autophagy. So not only do we get the caffeine fat loss benefits, but we get the polyphenols in coffee that are actually helping our cells recycle, meaning, again, the 2, 3, 4 calories you get from straight black coffee have a powerful effect that far, once again, supersedes the effect of having a couple calories potentially breaking your fast. Let's add on to coffee really quick and talk about green tea. Okay, because coffee's got all these benefits with caffeine and the polyphenols and stuff, but green tea, we really crank it up a notch. You see, remember those catecholamines I talked about? Remember epinephrine and norepinephrine, how powerful they are? That's such an impetus for the results of a fast, right? The good success. Well, those things break down in your body. Adrenaline's released and it has its magic in your body, but eventually the adrenaline wears off. Well, cool thing is, green tea has these specific catechins. Maybe you've heard of EGCG before. Well, EGCG is what does the magic. EGCG has something known as catechol-O-methyltransferase. All right, complicated word, you're so cool, Thomas, whatever. Point is, all that stuff does is it stops the breakdown of the adrenaline or slows it down. So that means that precious adrenaline that's released, burning fat in your body, now doesn't break down as fast, so it's more active for a longer period of time in your body, burning more fat. Because of this, we have this indirect increase in thermogenesis, right? It's basically causing our body to emit more heat. So green tea, in addition to the caffeine, is causing the body to emit more heat. Now, let's go ahead and look at a study that proves that green tea actually increases your resting energy expenditure. So this one was published in the American Journal of Clinical Nutrition, and it was wild because it took a look at 10 men, and these 10 men, it gave them either a green tea extract, caffeine, or a placebo. And they wanted to measure what happened with their resting energy, their metabolism. Well, it turns out that those that took the green tea extract had a 4% increase in their resting energy expenditure. Simply put, that means that these people just, they took in green tea extract, they didn't do anything different, and their metabolism increased 4%. And it had nothing to do with the caffeine that was in the green tea. It was purely the green tea extract, purely the polyphenols and the catechins. So really powerful stuff outside of just the caffeine. If you guys are interested, I did put a link down below for what's called Yujito Matcha. Matcha is a really powerful green tea. You've probably heard of it. It's going to have the least negative impact on your body as far as the calories go, but also the most powerful effect as far as the polyphenols and the EGCG goes. And Yujito is a 180-year-old matcha company. They have authentic Japanese matcha, so super, super cool. Plus, they have little packets that you can use to make fasting really easy when you're on the go. So definitely want to check them out if you want to get your green tea game on. They're just awesome, and they're also a huge sponsor of this channel and make these videos possible. So just check them out as a courtesy too. The next one is really simple. It's called salt water, and it's just like the name implies. Now, some people have called it snake juice because a guy named Cole, who created the snake diet, talks about it and calls it snake juice, where it's basically just concentrated salt water. But I don't necessarily recommend going super concentrated. What I might recommend is for every like 1 liter or so, you might want to do maybe 2 teaspoons. So still pretty salty water, but not insanely salty. The point is, when we look at our cells, it's something like this. 70% of the fluid is on the outside of the cell, and 30% is on the inside. When you lose sodium, that ratio gets thrown off and it throws off the electrical signal. And when you're fasting, your insulin levels are really low because you're not eating. So normally when you eat, insulin goes up. Well, in this case, you're not eating, so insulin goes down. Well, chain reaction with that is the kidneys lose a lot of water. They expel water. It's just a natural response, right? So kidneys drop water, and then all of a sudden you're losing electrolytes. Well, what happens there? You feel foggy, you feel funky, and you don't feel good. That's where adding some salt comes in. So it doesn't need to be anything complicated. It's just the newer research is showing that adding salt to water during a fast is really powerful. One other fun mention though, if you've ever craved something sweet while you're fasting, it's probably not because you're really craving something sweet, it's because you're craving something salty. And the NST receptors, basically these neurons, are firing and sending the wrong signal. So when you're hungry and craving salt, your body sends a signal to your brain that you need salt, but it gets crossed with other signals and actually makes you crave sweets. So if you crave sweets during a fast, having a little bit of salt might just fix that issue. Lastly is a little bonus one. If you're towards the end of your fast and you don't want to be caffeinated, ginseng tea is a great way to go. So ginseng is going to give you that kind of mental boost because it helps support and helps release acetylcholine. So it stops the breakdown of acetylcholine rather. So it makes it so you have the neurotransmitter in your brain that allows you to function properly. And acetylcholine grows synapses. So these little gaps in between your neurons, the synaptic cleft, it grows that synapse so that the neurons can communicate with each other. Long story short, you get the mental brain boost without the caffeine whole part right there. So you just need that little focus, it's gonna help you. Plus, it improves blood flow to the brain. Here's what's interesting. When you're fasting, you have this hormetic effect where you have lactate and other things that are going to your brain to some degree, causing BDNF, which is basically brain fertilizer. It's complicated. I'm just trying to make it really simple. When you're fasting, you have all these effects that can grow brain cells. Really powerful stuff. It's why you feel smart when you're fasting. You combine that with the increase in blood flow that you get from the ginseng tea. Do the math. Here it is. Plain and simple. ACV plus lemon, black coffee, matcha green tea, salty water, and some ginseng tea. That's it revised for this year. Anyhow, it's gonna change because research always does. And that's why you should keep it locked in on my channel. So I'll see you in the next video.